Hello everyone, I'm Srivanti and I'm currently working as an ML engineer. Okay, so I'll be covering around 35 interview problems on regression. I have covered basic concepts and maths behind regression in this video, link in description. And I would strongly recommend seeing that video before starting to solve the interview problems. And I've also discussed implementing linear regression from scratch using Python here in this video again, link in description, which is extremely important for hands-on coding. And the interviewer might ask you to implement a class for the same. Also, often the interviewer may ask you to use like standard libraries directly for solving the problem instead of implementing from scratch. And for that case, this video is very important. So this video, I have discussed how you can implement linear regression using standard library like scikit-learn. That's about sums it up. And so I'll also be showing the problem and give approximately, I don't know, 5 seconds or 10 seconds for you to solve the problem, to pause the video and solve the problem. And then you can match the answer. I'll discuss it then and there. For some of the questions, I'll also be using the board behind me as well. I think that's it. So I would definitely recommend seeing this video till the end and trying to solve all the problems here. And this will definitely strengthen your preparation for the upcoming interviews. All the best. Let's go. Okay, so the first question that comes is, what is linear regression and how is it used in predictive modeling? Okay, so what exactly is linear regression and what is predictive modeling? Right. So this is like you have to answer in like less than 2 to 3 sentences, and then with each follow-up question, the interviewer might dig deeper into your knowledge base and how much you know. But try to keep the first answer short and sufficient. So here, what would you say is like the linear regression is actually a very popular machine learning algorithm. What it does is it finds out the relationship between a dependent variable or the target variable and one or more independent variables or the features. And like this, how does it actually do that? It is actually done by finding out the fitting, actually by fitting a line in case of simple linear regression, and or a plane in case of multiple linear regression that fits the trend in the data. I mean that best fits the trend in the data. And this line is actually line on the plane is actually called the best fit line or the best fit curve. And like how is it used in predictive modeling, right? So this is actually used for predicting in case we do not know the final target value. So suppose we have a set of data where you're trying to find out the house prices. So the house price can depend on number of bedrooms, the location, the proximity to the market, the number of the square feet area, and I mean the place, the location, as I said. So it depends on a lot of these factors, and all these factors determine finally the house price. So these factors are like can change at any point of time, and it's not possible to have a house price which have like lots and lots of like data where you have all the house prices possible for all combinations. So here we are predicting the house price. So this is one example of predictive modeling. You can shorten it down, definitely, but this is like the gist of it. Okay, now comes the second question. What is the difference between simple and multiple linear regression? So I've discussed simple linear regression before. It involves one independent variable and one dependent variable. So it fits a straight line. Basically, the equation is something like this. Y equal to mx plus c, right? So this one, it has only one x, which is the feature, and m is the weight, and c is the bias, and y is our target variable. So generally we represent like this, and we try to find this line, which is the best fit line in case of simple linear regression. Now the next thing that comes is, what is the multiple linear regression? So it has more than one independent variable, and it fits a plane. So this is very important. There are two differences between the simple and multiple linear regression. Definitely the number of independent variables and also the best fit curve, which is a line in the case of simple linear regression. And in multiple linear regression, it's a plane. So the equation in that case would be something like, this would be for multiple linear regression, and the first one is for simple linear regression. Okay, so the third question that comes here is, what are the assumptions that are made in linear regression modeling? So the obvious one is that like the linear regression must have a linear relationship between the independent variables and the dependent variable. I mean, otherwise it's not, I mean, otherwise linear regression is definitely not the algorithm to use in that case. You can use other algorithms, definitely, but linear regression is not the way to go. Next thing that is very important is basically the error term that should be normally distributed. So this is the equation, and this epsilon is the error term which should be normally distributed. So now comes why. So if you have watched my video of log likelihood, what is log likelihood? So there I've discussed in great detail why the error term should be normally distributed. So here I'll play this video, just the part where I've discussed why epsilon is normally distributed in linear regression. If you've already watched the video and you already know this, you can skip to this part, skip to the next part. But for the others, you can watch it for the next a couple of minutes. So if you remember, just now I wrote a formula, this one, and this is the noise. So we want the noise to be generated by Gaussian distribution. So what would that look like? So that would be like, transpose xi square. So this is the noise. This is the probability distribution function of the noise. So let's just consider like sigma, and sigma doesn't have a meaning here. I mean, we know what it means in normal Gaussian distribution, but here it doesn't have a specific meaning. We can treat it as like a general constant. So now we'll see the magic happening. So this, if you remember this one, try to remember this. So now what we'll do is something different. So this one, this function that you have right here is this noise, right? This noise is this function that you have right here. So now we will, so and if you remember this one, this is actually the one that we wrote like right now, the function for likelihood. So now we'll use log likelihood.
Why?
It's easier to like differentiate when it's in the log format, and also the variables, they are more easy to deal with. So P. So this one would be P, probability of yi given xi parameterized by theta. I just now said this one. Right, this one. And this would be for all the data points. M is a number of data points. Now we will take the log of this, log on both sides. So what would that look like? Summation I equal 1 to m. This is what it would look like, right? So now this is just a constant, so we won't take it any further. And this one is actually what matters. Constants we can deal with later because we are anyway minimizing the loss or maximizing the likelihood. So it doesn't really matter. Yeah, so this one, then log comes this. Let's take it down. You'll soon see that it looks very familiar. See this. What does this look like? The least squares function. Exactly, correct. Yeah, so now you know why the error term should be normally distributed. And now the third assumption, which is very important, is that the independence of the observations. The observation that you must have should be independent. So for example, you have 1 million points in your data set, and it's very important that all these points, they should be independent of each other. This is very important. Oh, there's one more assumption, which is very important, is that like the features, they should be linearly independent. We should not have any correlation between the two features. One more thing is that like this is not exactly an assumption, but the residuals should be normally distributed. So like this already gets covered in the second point that I mentioned, that the error term should be normally distributed. So you can also say the residuals if this term is being used by the interviewer. So the residual means the difference between the predicted value and the observed value. So this difference, that one is called the residual, and this is the error term also, and they both should be normally distributed. So I've already shown why. You must keep a note of this. This is like very important for the interview. Next question is, how do we interpret the coefficients of a linear regression model? So this is a fairly easy question. So I'm actually covering all the easy questions first, and then slowly and steadily the questions will get a bit tougher. But the easy questions are definitely asked in internships, definitely, and placements as well. So the coefficient, what does it mean? So the coefficient actually means the feature weights, right? So in the independent variables, they all have certain feature weights. And for example, suppose y equal to mx plus c. So m would be the feature weight and c would be the bias. I'll come to the use of the bias in a bit. And so we are now talking about the m. In multiple linear regression, you would have y equal m1 x1 plus m2 x2 plus m3 x3 dot 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 plus c, right? So what does the coefficient actually indicate? So if keeping all the other like features constant, if you change the feature, suppose x1 by 1 unit, then the feature weight, which is the m1, will determine how much change will there be in the target variable. So this is basically the basic interpretation of the coefficient. So there can be two types of coefficients. So these are like continuous predictors, which is the one that I just now mentioned, y equal m1 x1 plus m2 x2. There are also ones that are dichotomous predictor, so which is like male or female, yes or no, so 0 or 1, and that also helps us in the same way to determine whether we will be actually having like what would be the change in the target variable. Okay, so the next question that comes is, what is multicollinearity and how it can affect a regression model? Okay, so what does exactly multicollinearity mean? So it occurs in a regression model when actually two or more the independent variables of the features, they are highly correlated with each other. So what does that mean? So basically it means that suppose we have y equal to m1 x1 plus m2 x2 plus dot 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 plus c, where x2 is equal to 3 times x1. So this means that whenever we have any change in x1, we exactly know how x3 is going to change. That is one predictor variable. It can be linearly predicted from the others with a very high degree of accuracy. So which means that the number of features actually is not n. If you're having x1 to xn, it is actually n minus 1 because x2 is very highly correlated with x1. So this actually leads to redundancy among the predictors. So I mean, it has a lot of implications on the data. First thing is that we use metrics like root mean square, or we use metrics like mean squared error. So in those cases, the error is actually larger than it actually sh than the standard error. So that is why this actually makes wrong predictions. We should not do that. Also, one more thing is that like it decreases the power of the data to generalize on new data. Why? Because suppose if you have like two features that are same, so this means that the number of features are decreasing, right? So you don't have that much variation in the data anymore. You don't have too many features on which the data depends. You are having less number of features. So which means that the model is unable to understand and generalize to new data because it overfits on the current data, because the features, they are now redundant. So this is very important, and the way you can detect that when before training the model is by using a correlation matrix. So that is very important. So if you just have a correlation matrix among all the integer variables, so I have shown that in one of my videos, like basics of NumPy, pandas and matplotlib video. In the pandas one, you actually have a function there which can directly find the correlation matrix very easily. So that is very important to do before you start training the data on the linear regression model. This is very important. Okay, so this video covers first five easy questions for interview on regression. The next video will cover the next five questions. In total, I have 35 questions for interview problems. And yeah, so I think that's it for this video. Please subscribe and stay tuned. Thank you.